Good morning and welcome to our second Sunday of Advent. Advent means coming or expecting, and it's good to see all of you here coming and expecting a wonderful worship service. So welcome all of you, whether you're first time or whether you've been here many times. What are you expecting as you come for an Advent service? If you were receiving a king, what would you expect? Luke, in his description, says, here is where the Messiah was born. An empty manger is what we have here. Such a simple setting. The stable, you know, that's really just a barn, and a manger with some straw here. It's so unpretentious, modest, genuine, natural, real, simple, yeah, very simple, and sincere. Nothing phony here. All, including the poor, can relate to Jesus. All except perhaps the rich and the proud, ones who can only accept a fancy king, a winner, glitzy, whose kingdom is earthly, superficial, visible, temporary, passing. This Jesus, this Messiah, will not have anything to do with that. His kingdom will be just like him, of the highest integrity, most solid character, most personable, most relatable, nothing to do with arrogance or ego. Yeah, if you want a fancy, snappy, snazzy, superficial king, you're looking in the wrong place. But if you're looking for a good king, a ruler who is really good, then you are looking in the right place. Today, our theme is about Jesus. We have this prophecy, and Jesus comes with simplicity, and that's a surprise. In Luke's account, our first passage this morning is from the disciples of John the Baptist, and they came. John had questions about Jesus. Do we often come times with questions or maybe even doubts? Yeah. Well, if you have questions, you're in the right place. So even John the Baptist had questions for Jesus. You're in good company. This comes from Luke chapter 7, verses 18 through 23. Luke chapter 7, verses 18 through 23. The disciples of John reported all these things to him. So John summoned two of his disciples and sent them to the Lord to ask, are you the one who is to come, or are we to be waiting for another? When the men had come to him, they said, John the Baptist sent us to you to ask, are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another? Jesus had just then cured many people of diseases, plagues, and evil spirits, and had given sight to many who were blind. And he answered them, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised, the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me. This was good news. Surprising news? Yeah. But good news nonetheless.
We're planning to sing a number of Christmas songs through this season, with quite a few of them on the Sunday right after Christmas. But today we're going to sing the first two songs. The first one is O Little Town of Bethlehem. These songs, the first two songs today, are very familiar to you.
Shine of the everlasting. and praise us sing to God the King, and peace to all on earth. How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of the heavens. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, and weak souls will receive till the dear Christ enters in. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend on us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
And turn the page over to 194, Away in a Manger.
I think I'm on. Children, if you would come up front. We have another symbol to talk about this morning. And you can sit right down here. Am I doing something to make that happen? So last Sunday, we talked a little bit about all the symbols, the stable, stars, angels, all the symbols of Christmas, and then the Advent wreath, and we lit our first Advent candle. Well, this morning we're going to talk specifically about the manger. A manger is another symbol that reminds us of Christmas, and we know that baby Jesus was placed in a manger, but what were mangers really used for? Do you know?
Babies.
Babies? There really weren't supposed to be something for babies to be in. Do you know what mangers are really for? Tell us what mangers are really for.
To put food in for animals.
Yeah. Do you see the hay up here for the animals? It's really for animals to eat. It was a place for animals to eat out of, and that's where they put baby Jesus. In some countries, because Jesus was born in a stable and in a manger, they put juicy apple cores in the manger or out for the animals on Christmas. And so today I have an apple for you to eat. And as you eat this apple, I want you to imagine Jesus coming and being born with animals. Now, take a look at these apples, because these apples are clean and sweet and delicious. But stables and barns where animals are usually smelly and dirty. I wonder what it would have been like. Have you ever wondered what the animals were thinking? I mean, there were people in the barn with them. So I've been hearing, I know that you do this with Martha, I've been hearing you sing the Friendly Beast song in the morning, so how about if you sing that song for us right now with Winfried and Martha. So you guys come stand up here. You can join them if you'd like. Down, we're going to sit a little closer to the lights this time. So I have a question, another question. Do you think it was peaceful in the stable? I mean, there's animals in there. Do you think it was peaceful in there? Maybe?
Well, it would be
Do you think the animals were noisy and moving around?
Well, the table was big.
It was big?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, our second candle is the candle of peace. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of hope, and Lucas is going to light them for us. Can you light this first one right here? We remember the hope that comes with Christ. But this Sunday, we light the candle of peace. And we dream of a peaceful world where lions and lambs can eat together, where cats and dogs sleep peacefully together. We dream of a peaceful world where nations come together and we can all eat at one table. Take an apple and you may head back to your seat.
Do they have any seeds in them?
They do.
I'm going to take one for my brother too.
You may.
Could you please take them?
Your mommy will do that for you.
Along with our second candle here, the candle of peace, we have a litany that we can share together. I will read the first part and you can join in the second part. A litany of peace. In a world where so many experience violence, God lights a candle of peace in our hearts. We wait together for a Savior who will be Emmanuel, Christ the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord.
By the tender mercy of our God,
next, we're going to sing two songs together, the song, What Child Is This?, and The Helpless and Hungry. So if you want to follow in the books, it's the What Child is in 215 in your worship book, and sing the story. 26 is The Helpless and Hungry. The first verse we're going to sing is the first of Helpless and Hungry, and you can all sing along on that. Then we will sing the first verse of What Child Is This? Then we're suggesting that we divide up and ladies sing verse 2 of Helpless and Hungry, and the men stay on What Child Is This? Verse 2, and we'll do verse 3 then the same way as that. So hopefully you can follow along. I'll be leading the Helpless and Hungry, and Roy will be leading the What Child Is This? So hopefully that'll help you to know which one to follow.
Angels greet with anthems sweet.
Our second scripture comes from the Gospel of Luke as well. And this is Luke's description. This is exactly how it happened. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken by Quirinius, was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. Mel?
Does it strike anybody as just a little bit odd that last Sunday we were talking about honoring our great and mighty God with a lampstand made of pure gold, and this Sunday we're talking about the Son of God being born in a stable and sleeping on a bed of hay? What a contrast, eh? Now, don't get me wrong, I've actually slept on a mattress that was stuffed with straw before, a long time ago, and I think it was only once. Can't say it was the most comfortable bed I ever slept in, but it wasn't the worst one either. But a manger? A place where animals normally hung out? Couldn't God have planned this event to take place in a nicer environment, in nicer surroundings? Couldn't God have planned things out so it wouldn't have happened quite this way? I mean, for the entrance of his son, the baby Jesus, coming into the world? Actually, that manger might have been one of the cleaner parts of the stable. What was it like for Mary and Joseph in this barn where she gave birth to a baby? I agree, Barb. Can't help but wonder exactly what that would have been like. And yet there is something about this Christmas story that I think speaks volumes to us about the very character of God and God's plan for the salvation of the world. So let's take a look at what this symbol of a manger might mean to us today. Luke's well-researched gospel account of the birth of Jesus tells stories about how heavenly messengers were at work behind the scenes before this event even took place, announcing the unusual birth to the soon-to-be mother, Mary, as well as the birth of a baby to Mary's relatives, Zechariah and Elizabeth. I think some of you were studying about them in Sunday school class. And they too were to have a son to be named John, who would come to prepare for the coming Messiah. And in our text verses today then, this familiar Christmas story, and we'll be looking at it again in just a few weeks. And it also, in this story, Luke includes just a little bit of the context of when and how this all happened. And in particular, the rather harsh political reality into which the baby Jesus would be born. We hear about a national census. Doesn't say exactly why. We'd have to assume maybe it was because they wanted to know how many of these Jewish people there actually were. After all, they had to keep them under control. So maybe it was sort of a security kind of thing to get everybody registered and enrolled so they would know exactly what and who they were dealing with. Most inopportune time for these earthly parents of a heavenly king. They had to take this long and difficult journey to Bethlehem. And we'd probably just as soon ignore all of that part, that context, that behind-the-scenes stuff, and move right on to the story of Joseph and Mary arriving in Bethlehem just to find that there was no room in the inn. But it helps for us to perhaps understand a little bit of that context. After all, this whole thing about the Roman Empire ruling over the land of the Jewish people that keeps popping up time and time again throughout the gospel accounts of Jesus' life and ministry. And then we think about this innkeeper that we don't actually hear anything about in the Bible, right? Doesn't really say anything about an innkeeper, but we sometimes describe him as a scoundrel who turned Mary and Joseph away because he didn't have any place for them. Or sometimes people say maybe he was a hero. After all, he did make room for them in the stable, which was maybe the only place that was available. But he probably was an ordinary citizen, overwhelmed by all the people coming to town looking for a place to spend the night. I mean, what was he or she supposed to do? Throw somebody out in the streets to make room in this noisy, crowded inn? You ever think about all of those Christmas symbols that we're so used to seeing and thinking and talking about at this time of the year that wouldn't even be a part of the Christmas story if Mary and Joseph had found room in a boarding inn? Or even better yet, if they had been able to find some nice guest room to stay in that night. They have to wonder, don't you? Was this whole thing really a part of God's planning for sending His Son into the world? And if so, why? Why the government census? Why no rooms available in Bethlehem? And maybe most of all, why did the birth of Jesus have to take place on that particular night when Mary and Joseph were relegated to spending the night in a stable? And believe me, I don't have all the answers to those questions. But I think they are worth us at least giving a look at them and thinking about them a little bit. Even some of those seemingly meaningless details that we have recorded in Scripture about this event, some of those were later seen as evidence proving that this baby in a manger was truly the Messiah sent from God. Just an example, you go back to Matthew's account of the birth of this baby, and he begins by tracing his genealogy, his family history, 14 generations from Abraham down to King David. King David was a highly respected and loved ancestor to whom the royal lineage had been promised. 14 more generations from David down to the time of the Jewish deportation to Babylon. That was one of the lowest points in the history of the Jewish people. And then 14 more generations have come and gone, with Joseph now prepared to stand in that line as the earthly father of the Messiah. Yeah, maybe those details aren't so important to us, perhaps, but it meant something to the people who lived at that time, who needed to understand and believe that this truly is the Messiah. And then it was that census. It just happened to be at that time, right? But that's what caused Joseph and Mary to travel from their home up in Nazareth down to Bethlehem. And then what did the scholars say when King Herod inquired of them where a king of the Jews might be born? Well, in Bethlehem of Judea, they said, for so it has been written by the prophet, and you, Bethlehem, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. Might have saved a lot of trouble if they hadn't shared that information with the king, right? But isn't it amazing how all of those different parts of the Christmas story came together in a specific way that lined up with a prophecy from years before? And while the Jewish people naturally were thinking about this promised Messiah as one who would come and lead them in a revolt against the Romans, the prophet Isaiah, several hundred years earlier, had already written about a Savior who would come from humble beginnings, and who would lead the people as a shepherd who cares for his flock rather than a man of military might. So what better way, when you think about it, to present this humble Messiah to the world than to spend his first night surrounded by conditions that many a shepherd might have expected or experienced in their caring for the sheep, either out on the hillside with not much of anything of comfort around them, or in a sheepfold somewhere with maybe a bit of hay on which to lay their heads. And these simple surroundings, they would continue to be a hallmark of Jesus' ministry, even during those years that we have recorded in Scripture of his public preaching and teaching and healing. You may recall that at one point, there was a young man who declared that he was going to follow Jesus. You remember the reply that he got from Jesus? Pretty revealing, actually. "Foxes have dens to sleep in," Jesus said, "but the Son of Man has no home to call his own, and not even a bed to sleep in." That last evening, when Jesus spent with his disciples before he was arrested out in the garden on the Mount of Olives, pretty sure that wasn't the only night he and his disciples had spent outdoors, sleeping on the ground, where maybe a bed of hay would have actually seemed like a really luxury. And perhaps it was at least in part this simple lifestyle of Jesus and his disciples that caused John the Baptist to ask his famous, or maybe we might think infamous, question: "Are you the one to come, the Messiah, or should we wait for another?" Now, John himself had lived a rather austere lifestyle. He spent his days preaching out in the wilderness, wearing the most simple clothing, eating whatever food he could gather. But the Messiah? Shouldn't there be something better than that for the man chosen by God to lead his people out of their situation of bondage and darkness? And Jesus doesn't try to explain his living conditions or why he chose to depend on the hospitality of others rather than to have a house and a bed of his own. Instead, he points out the results of his ministry, the healing, the hope he has given. And he says to John, "Blessed is anyone who takes no offense in me." What I hear him saying there is, accept me the way I am. Don't try to make me fit in to your idea of what the Messiah should be. Yeah, a simple bed of hay. A baby sleeping in a manger because there was no other place where he could be laid. It's really rather fitting when you stop to think about it, and when we think about the life that was to come. So what does this symbol of a manger in a stable mean to us today? I had to think about it because there's probably millions of nativity sets that either are or will soon be set up in our homes across the country, right? How many of you have a nativity set already up in your home? Yeah, I see a few hands up. Probably every one of them has some kind of a backdrop resembling a rough shelter designed to house animals. Probably with Mary maybe seated on a mound of hay, Joseph dressed in spotless robes despite the horse and the cow and the few lambs gathered around. Shepherds with their shepherd's crooks, wise men with their camels and their precious gifts, angels hovering overhead and a bright star giving light to everything. And all, in every nativity set that I've ever seen, all of those characters are focused in on one thing: the baby in the manger. With reverence and awe, looking to see what was there, fast asleep, we hope, at least part of the time, on his bed of hay. The very picture, if you can imagine it, the very picture of peace on earth, goodwill among all of creation. Now, when I think about that, I suspect that a lot of it is probably wishful thinking. It's probably from an artist's rendering of the Christmas story, in which the reality of giving birth in a smelly barn among all those animals is sort of sanitized, rearranged to fit in our comfortable homes and churches. But there is still a message of hope to be seen in those nativity settings. Because the God of all creation did not come into this world to live a lifestyle of the rich and famous, or even the middle class and comfortable. The ruler of the universe would be worthy of the best that all this world has to offer. A golden lampstand or a palace filled with the finest gifts one can imagine, they wouldn't even begin to measure up to the greatness of our Almighty God. And yet, when the Son of God came to live among us, began his life as a tiny, helpless baby, just like every one of us, just like you and me, came into the world. And he identified himself not as royalty, which you could have claimed, but he identified himself with the blind and the lame and the deaf and the sick. People whose worth or value is often discounted by the society in which we live, and sometimes, yes, even by the very people who are trying to follow the Savior of the world. Now, Jesus probably didn't sleep in that manger for very long. Actually, the story of the visit of the wise men describes him and his mother in a house. But I think that image of that bed of hay sort of remained with Jesus throughout his life on earth. Gives us an image of what, heaven probably won't be quite like that, but certainly with the understanding that's how the ruler of the universe would live. And it calls us, it reminds us of what is truly of value in God's kingdom. The worth that God places on every single person who is born, and the extent to which Jesus was willing to go in order to provide for our salvation and life eternal for those who are willing to accept and receive him. So what do we make of that peaceful, stable scene at Christmas time? Did the birth of the Christ child bring instant peace to this world in which he was born? Not so you would notice. In fact, it was only a short time later when Joseph would have to pack up his wife and newborn son and whatever few possessions they had with them, slip away in the dark of night, become a migrant family seeking refuge in the land of Egypt in order to escape the wrath of King Herod that fell on that region around Bethlehem. In Roman rule, that would continue for a number of years. Citizens' rights were few and far between. Jesus himself would die a violent death, as would many of his followers. What does that peace of Christmas really mean then? I mean, we often hear, we associate the word peace with our celebration of Christmas. And perhaps in times past, maybe our wish would have been more about worldwide peace, where nations would live together in peace. Today, many of us might be longing for just a bit more peace in our homes, in our communities, for our nation, for the people that we love. Is there any way to lay hold on this seeming peacefulness of the people and the animals gathered in and around that stable that night? Is there any way for us to hold on to the innocence of the little lambs or the watchfulness of the shepherds? All coming together in a specific time and place to mark the arrival of a Savior, the Christ child, born into this world. I wonder, could that symbol of a manger, a simple bed of hay, providing a place for Mary and Joseph to lay their sleeping baby, could that become for us a reminder of God's desire for peace for the human race and for all of God's good creation? Because the world around us, it's going to continue to be a turbulent place of violence and unrest as long as there are people who seek to rule over other people, as long as there are people who put their own best interests ahead of the needs of everyone else. God does not force His way of peace on us. And in fact, true peace can never be forced on anyone. But in the birth of Jesus, we have been shown that peace with God is available to us through the birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. And perhaps that simple manger with its bed of hay can even give us something of a clue about how it is possible to live at peace with each other in the world. The humble beginning, the humility that it was required for the Son of God to come into that kind of a mean beginning. If we were to practice that kind of humility in our own lives, would it bring peace in our relationships with the people around us? We do need to remember, though, that that peace that Jesus brought with Him still led to His rejection and suffering. Following Jesus does not ensure that we will live at peace with all men. Today we have lit the candle of peace along with the candle of hope. Together they speak to us of a true reason for celebrating Christmas, the coming of Jesus into the world. Next Sunday we're going to be looking at another symbol of Christmas, those angels who played such an important role in preparing Joseph and Mary and others for the part they were to play in the birth of the Christ child. And we're also going to consider the message of those angels, particularly when they were out there on the hillside singing to those shepherds, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come." I always look forward to that particular Sunday during Advent. And my prayer for all of us today is that the hope and the peace and yes, even the joy of Christmas will seep into the cracks and the crevices of our hearts and our minds, maybe in a new way, so that we can honor the greatness of the God that we serve as we celebrate Christmas this year with the very best that we have to offer of ourselves, of our resources, all that we have, while at the same time living in that same spirit of humility that was shown by our Savior being born in a stable, resting His head on a bed of hay. Let's pray. God, we are grateful for this time of year, for the reminders, because we so often forget, of the true meaning of the birth of Jesus coming into our world as King, as ruler over all, and yet as a tiny baby, vulnerable, coming into a place that was less than what many of us would think, even as the least of comfortable places, and yet identifying with the least of us. God, thank you that as we accept this Jesus into our hearts and our lives as Lord and Savior, we can have a hope that goes beyond our circumstances. We can have a peace despite whatever is going on around us. We can have a joy in knowing you. Help us to live that in our lives each day, and especially during this Christmas season. For we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior. Amen.
The songs I'm going to sing here, this one as well as the next one, are different than what's listed in the bulletin. Turn to number 206, Infant Holy, Infant Lowly. And while you're turning to that, I'd like to say a little something about sometimes things just crop up that catch a person off guard. And did you notice this morning when the children came up, there were 8 guys and 1 gal. When I grew up, there was my mother, there was 1 gal. There was my dad and their 7 sons, there were 8 guys. We were the same ratio. And one evening, growing up on the farm, we had lots of cattle, we had lots of hay and straw. And one evening they came in for what I called supper, you would call it dinner now. And there was one person didn't show. I wasn't there. And I've often wondered, I think my dad knew where I was because I was up in the barn sleeping on the hay. I needed more sleep than many of my brothers. My mom often told me that. And this particular day, I was not at the table. And when I woke up, I went down to the house and supper was basically over. And nothing was said about it. And I thought, boy, why didn't they come hunting for me? And I have a feeling that my earthly father knew exactly where I was, just like Jesus' heavenly father knew exactly where he was. He was laying on the hay. I was laying on the hay too. And what a meaningful coincidence to see this today as we do this. Okay, number 206, Infant Holy.
Infant Holy, Infant Lowly, for his bed of cattle stole, ocean low. Sleeping, shepherds keeping vigil till the morning new. Saw the glory, heard the story, tidings of a gospel true. Thus rejoicing, free from sorrow, praise us voicing, greet the morrow, Christ the baby.